All right, so it looks like it's slowing down a little bit, so we'll go ahead and get started. Hopefully everybody is seeing my screen. Again, welcome to the Competency Projects kickoff meeting. I'm going to quickly just do a kickoff here and go through the agenda. All right, so we're going to cover just a couple things, just webinar rules of the road, some more information about our ADL competency efforts, then specifically talk about CAS, the Competency and Skills System, and then we'll do wrap up, leave some time for wrap up and questions. Okay, so the rules, and I'm sorry for those of you who joined very early or are hearing this for the third or fourth time, but you'll notice when you come in that you are muted. We have a lot of attendees in this webinar, so just to keep things quiet and under control, everybody is muted. Don't worry, you can interact. The audio is fading out. Hopefully you can hear me okay. But to interact, you should see a questions section in your GoToWebinar control panel. There you can ask questions, and what we're going to try to do is answer as many as we can in line right in that questions panel. At times, we'll try to promote them up to the person that is presenting, and we'll do our best to keep up. There are quite a few people, so we'll stay on and try to get as many questions answered if you have a lot. No need to take huge amounts of notes. We're going to provide these slides later, and we'll let you know afterwards how you can get a hold of them. So don't worry about trying to write everything down. And then finally, this is really to be a kickoff. So we've got several competency projects at ADL. I've just listed a few here today that we'll get into later. We're going to focus on CAS today, but we have several other things that are going on. So we need your help in this. This is a community effort. Competencies specifically, even more than many of the other things that we work on at ADL, a lot of people are doing this in different ways. And because of that, the community is already invested, so we'll really need your help to make this the next big thing. So please make this the beginning of your contributions, and we'll talk a little bit about how to contribute down the road later in this presentation. Okay, so competencies. Why competencies? So, competencies do a lot of things. They can help us with our learning trajectory. They can help us give students comparisons against other students like them in their classes. It can help recommendation engines and many, many other things. But really what we're getting at here in a lot of these use cases is treating individuals as individuals and really giving them what they need, when they need it, not giving them too much or too little, not giving them things that are too complex or too easy. And all of this really hinges on the fact that we have a good way to handle competencies in the background. So a lot of the efforts that we have going on at ADL right now are focused on different aspects of this problem. So I'm not going to go into detail on all of these right now, and I've listed just a couple, and there's actually several more than this. And we'll have subsequent webinars and opportunities to see and contribute to these things. And always check out adlnet.gov, because all of our internal and external efforts are available there, at least in description, and in most cases you can get software specifications to look at it. So so make sure you check out what's out there. Okay, so what we're really here for is to kick off the CAS project, and soon here I'll turn it over to Robbie Robson, who is going to go through some slides and do an actual live demo of some of the early components. I think what's really interesting about this, and the reason I have the big ring on this slide, is because there's a lot of people in the community that are doing competencies in one way or another. And sometimes they're not calling them competencies, and we've learned that in another one of our efforts. I see Jim is on. So Jim from Ida, thanks for telling that. Actually, Jim, I thought about putting a mud puddle on these slides, but maybe that's too much of an inside joke. So there's a lot of different people that are doing a lot of different things. And to date, what has happened really over the last at least 15 years is people have tried to get on the same page as far as how to represent these competencies. So they create specifications in HTML or XML, and they try to represent these things in a standard way. And that works maybe within a specific community, but people have different use cases, they're tied to their systems, they support different protocols or different data formats, and because of that, pockets of isolation came about. So what CAS is going to do is, instead of looking at a whole new format that we try to enforce everybody to use across the entire community, that's a really hard problem. So CAS is coming at this from a different point of view, and it's not to create another standard, it's really to create some middleware between everything. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Robbie, and Robbie, I'm going to go ahead and make you presenter. And again, thanks everybody for joining us. There you go, Robbie, it's all yours.
Okay. Well, thanks so much. So just checking, everybody can see the slide that says Gateway to Competency Portability?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So so thanks so much, Jono, for the introduction and sort of setting the stage here. So we are going to talk today about the CAS project, and I will stop now and then to make sure that all of the questions get answered, and I've asked the ADL folks if there's something that comes up that seems like needs general explanation to go ahead and jump in and let me know, and one of us on the team will answer it. So first, a little bit of an overview. So the objectives of the project in sort of broad strokes are to enable competencies to function as a common language, common currency. This is what people obtain from training and education, are represented by credentials, and that they are and can play into careers. This is what people get hired to do. So we're interested in the skills, knowledge, ability, capabilities, attitudes, all of these things that are called in various ways and forms competencies. Another important thing is to allow them to be defined once and used many times, so that competencies that are defined in an organization or at a national level or even at a local level can be referenced by other systems, can be referred to in a uniform way, and can be understood by software. And so when we get down to the software level, really a lot of the project is about this sort of technical piece, which is to provide the infrastructure for this competency portability and also for competency-based learner profiles. And I will emphasize several times that what CAS is, and I think Jono sort of referred to this, is that we're really building infrastructure. We're not building standards. We may build a few demo end-user applications, but that's something that we expect to the community and particular end-users to be involved in. So within CAS, there are two basic kinds of objects. One is what we call competency frameworks. They're alternatively sometimes called competency models. And these are the sets of competencies that define or are related to a subject, a set of outcomes for learning activity, a job, a task, perhaps something even more general. There are properties, and later on when I show you the sites that are up, I'll show you where to look for and examine the properties that competencies and frameworks can have. But some of them, for example, are levels, so that people can hold competencies at the beginner or journeyman or master level, various vocabularies for that. They have relationships, so if somebody is an IT professional, they have to have competencies and skills in security, in configuration of systems, but also in managing personnel, in purchasing, in relating to other departments. So there's sort of hierarchical relationships, and these are expressed within these frameworks quite frequently. And then there's things called roll-up rules, which tell you how to assess the evidence or the ability of people to do things at sort of these lower levels, and how those roll up to the larger competencies. So, for example, to be an IT professional, you don't necessarily have all of those things in equal quantities, but somehow if you can demonstrate competence in all of those sub-competencies, then you might qualify for some sort of certification. So that's one thing. The second the second objects are competency profiles. So these are the assertions of what of individual competence. So this is about the people. So the frameworks are abstract. They just define things. There are competencies in there, but they don't actually say what competencies a particular individual has. The profiles are about what the competencies are that a person has. And we look at these as a set of assertions. The assertions presumably have some sort of source. They might have evidence associated with it, and they might have some sort of confidence in that assertion. And one of the things that we care deeply about in this are privacy and security. So one of the things that CAS has been designed from the start to provide is a sort of end-to-end security and privacy model. Anytime you have personally identifiable information, even if it's just a small system, an LMS talking to an LRS, we want to make sure that the people who own or the organizations that own the competencies have the can control access to it, that authorization is correct, that there's non-repudiation so that we know who's accessing it, and that the messages being sent are correct. So, as Jono mentioned, CAS exists within sort of a larger global ecosystem. And that ecosystem includes two main sorts of players. Some of them are standards bodies. There are some listed up here, the IMS Global Learning Consortium, Medviquitous does healthcare standards, healthcare education standards, the IEEE, et cetera, INLOC, there's some, and LRMI, the Learning Resource Metadata Initiative. So part of these are standards, and we're not a standards. CAS is not a standards, creating a standard, we're not a standards body. But one of the things that we will discuss in a bit is that a function of CAS is in some sense to translate between the standards, and we'll discuss why that is. The other kinds of organizations are the end users. So the ADL, for example, has some use cases that are driving this. The Department of Labor, there's a logo up there for Extension Foundation. We've been working with them. They represent cooperative extension professionals, university extension professionals in the United States. The Credential Transparency Initiative is a project that is looking at a registry for competency-based credentials. So there are these various use cases that are being driven by these, and of course we hope to find many more, and that some others will contribute them. So why are we doing this? So whenever you embark on something new, it's a good idea to take a look at what the current state is. And I know that Jono mentioned Jim has done a lot of work on this that's been contributed to the ADL and elsewhere. But in general, there are many, many competency frameworks out there. There are many people that use competencies. There's a rather large national and international movement towards competency-based education and approaches to training and staffing and other things like that. So there are some organizations, the Achievement Standards Network, which is now part of Desire to Learn, that maintains frameworks and maintains them in ways that can be accessed by machines and by computers and by URLs and APIs and things like that. More common, however, are other organizations that maintain frameworks that are essentially documents. They're on web pages, they've been developed, but they don't have any sort of machine actionable way of interacting with them. And as you can see, they're often as we mentioned earlier, there are lots of hierarchies, there's lots of different variations about this. Even if you have frameworks that can be accessed by computer and through URLs and APIs, it often is the case that local organizations want to create their own variations on those. So there's a need for both sort of creating a way for these competencies and these frameworks to be stored globally and accessed globally, and also for local organizations and local ecosystems to maintain their own variations on them and to synchronize with the master copies as well. So there's a lot of we'll call it plumbing, that needs to be done in order to achieve these goals of simply being able to refer to the same competencies and use them across multiple systems. So some of the use cases that are driving this the first, which is the ADL, so-called Personal Assistant for Learning ecosystem. And I don't want to I won't go into great detail here. The ADL certainly should, I'm sure we'll have a few things to say about this, but from our perspective, this is a system of very advanced systems that adapt to each individual's state, what they want to learn, what they've known, the skills, knowledge, and ability they already have, as well as their context. Are they perhaps driving in a car? Are they at their desktop? Are they in the field somewhere? These learning activities are provided by multiple systems. They could be intelligent tutoring systems. They could be a mobile phone. They could be something that's in an actual physical environment. And the problem is how do we connect all of these? And so in our view, CAS is providing a piece of the infrastructure that allows these to connect so that they can read and write to the same profile, so that when an individual goes through this, the systems can talk through CAS to each other and identify and make assertions about what the competencies are that a particular person has. So that's a fairly complicated scenario. A simpler one that we've been applying CAS to, I mentioned the Extension Foundation, is to just the problem of developing really and storing and applying the frameworks themselves. So in that case, there are professional development groups. We've done some work with a group, for example, that does climate literacy, and they develop their own frameworks. They're trying to move to a competency-based approach. Their LMS is Moodle 3.1, which is just been released or being released, that has some affordances in it for representing competencies and perhaps can be used to issue competency-based credentials. And the role that CAS plays is as the repository. It stores the competency frameworks, but also makes it very easy to put those into learning management systems. So credentialing is another one. We mentioned that. And the Credential Transparency Initiative. So credentials, so degrees and certificates and all of these things, we'd like to see those be based on competencies. And when you do that, there's an interesting problem arises. If you think of let's say, a healthcare professional. So they might have gone through some educational program and that was sponsored by Medicubitus. That's one of the organizations that does that. And they may have competencies in a format that was created by that was used using their standards. But they've probably also gone to college, and where in an ideal world, their degrees and the courses they've passed and so forth are tied to some competencies that may well be in let's say an IMS Global Learning Consortium format. There may be others that may have been in Europe. There may have been an INLOG format. There may be many different ways, most hopefully standardized, but some perhaps not, that these different credentials and different outcomes were represented. So even if you want to create a sort of uniform profile and a uniform picture of what somebody has, you need to be able to translate among all these different standards. So that's another role that CAS is playing as the sort of infrastructure and the translator among all of these different things. So those are some of the use cases that are currently driving us, our work, but this is a community effort. And so, you know, the most important use cases really are number five. And we certainly hope that you will contribute some of those, and that some of the people on this webinar and that get this later will sort of join this effort and start building some applications. But if nothing else, tell us what the requirements are that they have. So just kind of to summarize, and then I'll take a pause to answer some of the questions if there are any that need answering. So what CAS is really offering us is infrastructure. It is software, and it is offering a few different things. So one is shareability and interoperability, so that competencies and profiles, the competencies that are assigned to an individual, can be shared in an interoperable way. Machine readability of everything is important. There's persistent URLs, so in other words, there's a unique name for things so that different systems can refer to them. And it's a little more subtle than that, because not only is it a unique name, but it's a unique name that can be retrieved, and by retrieving it, you can find out more information, for example, the levels that are available, the description and other things from that URL. Security and privacy is a major thing, and then some simple tools. And the simple tools really are being built. We have to infrastructure is great, but you need to somehow manage it. And so there's some simple tools that are part of the sort of this first year CAS effort that are around to sort of manage the profiles, manage the frameworks, and also demonstrate how applications are built on top of it. So the next thing I'm going to do is actually take you to and show you some of the resources available. But before that, ADL folks, are there any questions that we should sort of jump in and answer at this point before we go and look at that stuff?
So Robbie, I think we're keeping up with most of the questions so far. So I think we're good at this point, and we can maybe save some time at the end.
Okay, excellent. All right. So what's in CAS? So there are three websites. Two. I'm going to show you today. I'll show you the GitHub site, but that's not going to be very very illuminating. There's a general site, the CAS website, which is casproject.org, that has a lot of the high-level documentation and resources. It's in some sense it's complete in terms of what's there, but in a very real sense, it's in its infancy. So you should expect this to grow and get considerably more things there as things evolve. And we also are providing a sandbox. So the sandbox is a place that you can go and play with the CAS components. You can also go to GitHub, of course, and if you have the capability of doing that, and download them and install them yourself. And as we'll mention later, we will provide some support for that as well. But the sandbox is a place to play, and it's as the name implies, you might build a sandcastle today, and somebody else might knock it down tomorrow. So it's not a place to keep sort of real stuff that's permanent, but it is a place that you can go and see how things work, and this will be built out over time as well to show more and more of the capabilities as they get developed. So the first one I'd like to do is show you the CAS project site. And so this is what it looks like. This is casproject.org, and I'm not going to what you can read the site on your own, but there's a sort of splash page, and it does explain the people that we're collaborating with, sort of what's this about, why competency, why this matters, and so on. And there's a tab for contributing, and you'll notice there's a schedule here. We'll go through that a little bit more later. There's a community launch meeting, for example, that's taking place today. And there's some links here. So if you click on the source code link, you will get eventually to the GitHub site, for example. There's a getting started site, and this has some things scheduled, which we'll also talk about later. Some further webinars and some what we call jam sessions that are more technical in nature that can help you do things. And then there's also a documentation tab. And I mentioned that if you wanted to see what was in, for those of you who are curious. You could go to this frame information model if this makes sense. Let me see if I can blow this up just slightly, okay? And then you'll see that there's various properties of frameworks. For example, frameworks hold competencies and relations among them. Competencies have names, descriptions, and so forth. And this is a place that you can go and dive into that and see what's sort of in CAS and how these things are represented. This model comes from our requirement to be able to translate and import and export from various kinds of standards. So that's the sort of overview site, and it will be built out over time. And of course, one of the links in there is to some communication methods, Slack in particular. And so if you have questions and want to make contributions or want to make comments or want something on it, there are plenty of ways to join the conversation and ask for those things. So yes, there's a GitHub site. So the GitHub site is this, and it's a GitHub site. And if you want to contribute and you want to have the right to commit to this, then please contact us and the project, and you'll be able to do that. So the sandbox I'm going to spend a little more time on because I think this will illustrate a little bit more as to sort of what CAS is. But I'd like to emphasize that CAS is the infrastructure behind this. And yes, there's some user interfaces here that you'll see. that allow you to look into it. But for most of this, gives you a chance to look into it. So there are three things on in the sandbox. One is something that allows you to manage the frameworks. One is something that allows you to look at profiles and play with those. And then there's a little bit of an end user application that is that we're building that allows you to tag resources in registries and repositories with competencies that are being maintained in the CAS system. So the first thing we'll do, though, is go and look at the at this. And as I said, if you go to the actual sandbox, you'll see everything that anybody put there. This is kind of a clean version. And there's a number of different frameworks in here. And here's one that we developed that is in ecology. And you can see that right away there's a URL here that can be used to access that framework. These are the competencies in it, and if we expand one, you'll see that there's a description. Again, another URL that can be globally unique ID URL that can be used to access this, and then there's some relationships. So niche identification requires biome identification, etc. And the other ones look very very similar. There's a few relationships. So that's what a very simple framework looks like. So here's one that is interesting in the fact in as much as that this was imported from the Achievement Standards Network. So you'll notice that the URL here is the sort of master URL for this particular framework. And indeed, if I click on this, you will get to the Achievement Standards Network. And it's maybe a little small to read, but This is the framework that was imported from them and is now being stored in CAS. For those interested, there is a CAS URL behind this that can be used as well. And this one has, for example, this high level earning income, which is kind of the high level one. You'll see has lots and lots and lots of relationships in here. And also, but most of them, of course, if we click on another random one, I actually don't know what's going to happen here. This says just one or two. So these are what this looks like. There's some other things you can do. You can export competencies, and in this case, it will export them in a CSV format, so that you could use these and bring these into your own system. And we can also import them. And right now, because this is our test case, the format that we'll import the JSON format from the Achievement Standards Network, but of course this will expand to all of those other standards so that you can import and export frameworks in all these different ways. Okay, so that's what this part of the sandbox looks like. You can also, of course, define new frameworks and then define new competencies within them. So that's the framework side. So this is the profile side, and this is a viewer. And so what's really going on here is that this page, if you will, is issuing some queries to the CAS system to retrieve the competencies across actually all frameworks in this case that a particular defined user had. So I'm logged in here as Mary Masters. You'll notice that there's a public key in here. The way that things are done in CAS is people's or organizations, everybody's identities are done with RSA keys, both for the purpose of signing things and also for non-repudiation. If I click on one of the competencies, you'll notice that this is sort of like it just says that Mary Masters has niche identification, 85% confidence, 4 pieces of evidence. So this is what evidence should look like. And again, you'll notice the all of these persistent URLs up there. There's an expiration date. This is part of the data model. So it's showing that. And then there's some evidence as to how this happened, where this came from, and there's different kinds of evidence that are provided for this. And then CAS is doing some operation. In this case, it's a rather trivial one to figure out what, if you ask it, you know, what does Mary, does Mary Masters hold this competency? It will say yes, but it also, if you noticed back in previously, it said that it had 85% confidence, so it did some computation with the confidences that were there. There are many, many different kinds of business rules and business logic that are possible here, and one of the principles that CAS is being built around is that a lot of these are configurable because we don't know, and I don't think there is any right way to do that. I mean, there are different use cases, and each use case is going to have a different thing. We can also you can view assertions. You can also create an assertion if you want to play with this. So we could there's a source, there's a target, so we could actually have Mary assert something about herself. We can take a different, there's the niche identification. This doesn't have any levels available. You can set the confidence and set the time, etc. And so there's this kind of user interface that is working with that. We can search these things. There's a lot of other operations that you can do now and that will continue to be built out so that you can play with these things in a sandbox setting. So that's sort of what profiles look like, and then there's an application that we've built that is meant to be, and actually was requested before we started this project by somebody that's working in the, that's now one of the working with the Credential Transparency Initiative, and her request was, you know, are there some simple tools for basically tagging things with these kinds of competencies. So this is a tool that just does, it doesn't, it's not a complicated interface, but this one is in fact live hooked up to the learning registry, and so we can search the learning registry, and if we want to search the learning registry, let's say tree, okay, if we search the learning registry for tree, we'll find various kinds of resources. This is just the learning registry search. And we'll take tree sparrow, and then some of them will have better definitions, so this will have more descriptions of it, wings and seeds. And so we'll select this one, and using the three of the verbs from the schema.org alignment object, we can say that this particular resource is, let's say, teaches, and then we can select the competency. In the ecology framework, and we'll say niche identification, select that, and then we could try to create an alignment. To actually create the alignment, you need to have a signing key, you need to have permission to store things in the registry. We won't do that. But this is useful, but in addition to that, this is a sort of a test application that is being built to show how this kind of infrastructure can be applied to one particular use case, namely tagging things in registries and repositories. And as it gets built out, and hopefully with some contributions from others, it will be able to put things in the right format, as it does now, so that it takes care of a lot of the things that you don't have to format the metadata, you don't have to figure out how to do the, what the tags are, what the IDs are, and all of that kind of stuff. That's what it's taking care of for you. Okay, so I'm going to stop there, and maybe this is a good chance to answer some more questions. So before we sort of go into just a few other things that we have to say, but are there questions that maybe we should answer at this point?
Yeah, so Robbie, this is Jono. I think maybe we'll ask two or three now, and I'm looking at, we are getting a huge amount of really great questions. So we do get a record of these after the fact, and a lot of them have already been answered in line. So maybe this is a good place to start with the frequently asked questions. So down the road, watch out, and we'll promote some of these so that they're available. But for now, Robbie, let's see. A couple of good questions. Okay. How does CAS connect with XAPI? And there were several follow-ups about the relationship between CAS and XAPI.
Yeah, so I'll answer that. Basically, CAS will ingest evidence in the form of XAPI statements, that is to say, it expects assertions to be transmitted in that format. It will also, the query, so it's acting in essence as a sort of mini LRS. It's designed to be part of that system that in which XAPIs operate. Fritz, do you want to add anything on that? I'm going to let some of our technical people sort of jump in.
We have, as part of CAST, we have a project, sort of a sub-project, to build an XAPI adapter with CAST. So that will be one of our examples of how a very different system would interact with CAST. So be able to ask questions of XAPI, XAPI would be able to ask questions of CAST,
Okay.
All right, great. Well, let's do, 3:37, let's do one more now. Is CAST recommending to have their own URLs like ASN does?
So we have the CAST project, CASTproject.org domain name, and the URLs will be the URLs outside of CAST will be there. Now, I don't know, Fritz, is it possible to configure it, an instance of it to use different domain names?
Yeah, so part of CAST is that we want this to be used by multiple parties outside of the CAST project. So for your school, you could set up a CAST instance and you would have URLs that are persistent and point at your CAST server to your competencies.
Okay, anything else at the moment?
I think we'll pause there, Robbie, so that you can move on. And if we have some time at the end, we can do more there. Thanks.
Okay. All right, perfect. So we're going to go back to this. Okay. All right. So one thing I want to talk about that is I think perhaps the most, if you would, the deepest part of CAST is this notion of assertions. So when we showed you the profile manager, I mentioned briefly that what it really is doing is asking questions about that particular user, Mary Masters in that case. When people think of learner profiles and competency-based profiles and transcripts, I think there's an image of this sort of lifelong record that anything you do and perhaps have not done gets recorded in this kind of big book somewhere that can then be accessed. That certainly is one view of the way things could be done, but it's not very flexible. And so instead, in CAST, we're not ruling that out. We obviously can do that, as you saw, through an application. But what CAST is really designed to do under the hood is something a little bit different, and that is it's designed to answer questions about a person and their competencies. And the way that it answers the questions is another system, can ask CAST for some information about a particular individual. Because of security and privacy, if you're not authorized to get an answer, CAST just doesn't respond. It doesn't tell you whether there's information there. It doesn't tell you that there's not information there. It just doesn't respond. It's silent. But if you are authorized, then what CAST will do is go out and try to find that information. It may have it somewhere internally, but in an ecosystem like the one that this personal assistant for learning one that the ADL is building, it will come in from other systems, from maybe an intelligent tutoring system, a learning record store somewhere, a credentialing system. These will come back, and then CAST will do the job of trying to collate them. And the reason that's important is that often what will happen is that data will come back at different levels of granularity. So we talked about roll-up rules and how things are hierarchical. But imagine, for example, that you're some sort of credentialing application, and what you're interested in knowing is if some student, I'll use a U.S. example, has an eighth grade student has demonstrated competence in one of the Common Core standards, or maybe a particular state standard. So if you go out and ask in this kind of electronic and connected world, that's the question that the credentialing system wants to know. But the evidence for that, the assertions that come from that, may come from a online course that the student took, which is broken up into several different modules, each of which has its own outcomes. And it may even come from an intelligent tutoring system that has taken this one common core standard and broken it into many, and in fact in the real world into hundreds of smaller bits, things like called knowledge components, that may be as specific as, can a student solve an equation, a linear equation where the coefficient is minus one? So that's one knowledge component in one particular system. And so CAS will get back evidence at many different levels of granularity, and as we mentioned earlier, in different standardized formats. And so its job is to collate that and to reply as best it can to that. And so this is the part that is a little bit different, but it's one of the reasons why we're doing it. And all along that, the security and privacy issues need to be enforced. So this is a different design thing. This is what we're sort of diving into now with some things that I didn't show you. We sort of have some mock-up systems that are talking to each other to try to figure out how this will work in the real world. So just to review a bit, so the important thing, I noticed there was a question, is CAS a, it may have disappeared by now, is it a standard or a framework or an application? Well, it is an application, it's infrastructure, it's software. It does support, it is in some sense a platform, if you want to put it that way, but it really is meant to lie under all of this. And it's not a standard. It does talk to other standards, and it can ingest and exgest, I guess, things in standardized formats. But the primary use is through a set of APIs. They're RESTful APIs, and the primary things are to refer to competencies through globally unique IDs, to import and export competency frameworks in standardized formats, and then to submit queries to concerning individuals to answer those queries for other systems. And what CAS is really meant to do is to take care of, as I said earlier, the plumbing. So to collate the insertions, to, for example, in the little app where we connecting to the learning registry, it's taking care of the connectivity so that you don't have to worry about doing that. You can configure it once and then start using it. Synchronization, what happens when you make local copies of frameworks and make variations on them, and the global copies change. Formatting things in the right way, security, privacy, those are important, persistence. So this is what CAS is, and it's on a schedule. So this is for this year, for the 2016. We have a release schedule. This is as with all open source projects. There's some flexibility that has to be involved, and of course, as others get involved, then maybe things can get accelerated. Maybe there are new things that are put in here. But one of the things that we are requesting is feedback. Even if you're not involved in writing code, which we hope some people do get involved in, we'd like feedback and comments. So the sort of competency framework piece is really the first half of the year. The profiles, although as you can see, we've already started them, and so forth, is sort of stretching on to the to September, to the fall here, spring in the other hemisphere. Assertion processing is ongoing, and it's just something that we're really starting to play with in a deep way. Resource alignment tool, and then community review is sort of the last chunk. So this is the project schedule that's up on the website. And as we saw earlier, there also are some sort of deeper dive pieces. So we have some scheduled. The exact dates will be on the website. You can find them there or via the Slack channel. And the two different kinds, really. Some of them, that they're all meant to be more interactive than this, hopefully. But there'll be the ones in black there, competency frameworks, will be a little bit more didactic. So it's somewhat akin to this kind of a webinar. And then the jams are really meant for people who are implementing things. And so the first one we have is in July. How do you download the stuff helping people install this, and I'm sure that we'll have many others. Really, it depends on how many are requested and you know, what issues come up. We'll also try to repeat some of these and record them, but also repeat them maybe in some of the different time zones so that it's easy for everybody to get on, and then we'll do something with integrating with other systems, and then finally, hopefully by October, we'll have enough other applications and some community applications and ourselves to really look at what all those applications are and how things are being used. So these are the channels. If you go to the this is the website we've seen, GitHub you've seen, you can sign up for Slack. I think if I click on this, it'll take us right to the sign up page. So there's a cast Slack channel, and if you sign up to that, that would be greatly appreciated. That will give you the opportunity to comment and to interact with the team and with the community. And that's what I have to say. So we have about a good 10 plus minutes for other questions and comments. So I'll turn things back over to Jono at this point.
All right. Thanks so much, Ravi. We have lots of questions, and thanks for everybody's patience. They're really coming in, and we are doing our best to keep up with them. So I have a couple here for you, Ravi. In assertions, how do you deal with mixed IDs? My current job ID is different from my previous job's ID, but I earn competency at my previous job.
Right. So, I mean, so that's only one of many problems, to be honest. I mean, so one of the things in XAPI and in all of this is that we need to be able to identify users. So users are being identified by their signatures, by keys, and hopefully there's ways to do that. Now, I mean, we can't reinvent the world infrastructure as to how identity management is done, but one of the things and one of the reasons why we want this to be a serious community project is that there will be issues like that we perhaps don't even have the complete expertise in, that others will and will be able to contribute. So that's my answer. I'm Fritz or Elliot. I don't know if you want to jump in and add anything to that.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, terrific. Yeah, I just want to jump in, and I promoted that question. I tossed that question up to you because I thought it was a great question. The fact is that this is a hard problem, and this is a problem that we're working on and thinking a lot about. Sometimes this is going to be easy. You're going to have systems in which previous employers aren't, some other job out there but are in the same ecosystem and want to share that information. But there are also going to be situations where this is difficult. And as Ravi said, that's exactly why it's an open source project, and we're looking to build a community around it to start breaking this and many other difficult problems down into more bite-sized chunks.
Okay. Jono?
All right, very good. Yep, so another one we have here is, will CAS results output become a JSON XAPI statement format, so minimal to no LMS development would be required, other than including it into reports?
Okay, Fritz, can you give a short answer to that?
Sure, yeah. The short answer is yes. Part of the requirements of the CAS XAPI adapter is the ability to translate those statements to and from XAPI.
All right, very good. I'm seeing a lot of people that are, interested in that XAPI and connection and prioritizing that. And yeah, definitely in ADL, we're interested in that. And keep an eye on the whole project. And hopefully, it's something we can do as a community together. Some of the different XAPI components. So great stuff. Elliot, Fritz, anything else? Any other questions?
Yeah,
all right.
We've got a couple of people asking for just some general information. What going forward will be the way community project can be shared? And I've seen a couple of other questions about where to find and how to get stuff. So I just wanted to remind people that the slides from today are going to be publicly available. They have in them links. You can also check out castproject.org. We've got Slack. We're super active on Slack. There's also, GitHub repository is open source. Just wanted to remind everybody about some of the stuff from the very beginning in case they missed it.
Very good. And anything else from your perspective, Fritz or Elliot?
I think I'm good. I have one here. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I said I'm seeing a bunch of questions that haven't been answered yet, and a lot of them have pretty straightforward answers. So, yes, you can get into Slack channels if you don't have an ADL email. Any email, any valid email will do. I don't know if Slack is blocked in some countries, but other than that, there would be no restrictions. As far as the license is concerned, all of the code is it's a Apache 2 license, so it's open source. It's up on GitHub. I can't do the can't hear him. Explicit to aid data processing. Are you making the meaning of competence explicit to aid data processing? Yes, as a matter of fact, in the data model there is a field, if you look at it, for performance criteria that you can add to that. Most competencies, by the way, do not have that in the real world, but certainly you can do that. The APIs published will be on GitHub and in the documentation. Provide a means to access the recording of this webinar. Jono, that's
yours. We're looking at that. I don't know, Craig, can you speak to that now? I can't tell if you are on with audio or not. But we have recorded and we are looking, I'll just say, we are looking at ways to distribute this broadly. Robbie will talk about that with you afterwards. I think not only are getting the slides out there, which we plan to do, we'll get everybody the slides soon, getting these questions cleaned up and out the door so everybody has these as a reference, and hopefully also providing a live recording so that if anybody missed it or you want to pass it along, we have that ability. So
yeah,
we'll be in touch after the webinar to provide additional information. But go ahead, Craig.
Everybody
right there.
Everybody that I contacted, hi, sorry, this is Craig. Everyone that I contacted via the previous email, I'll be following up with you all of you who showed up, so thank you, with a link to the recording of this session and also access to materials and hopefully some of these frequently answers to FAQs, because I think that would be useful because you guys asked a lot of questions. So yeah, don't worry about it. If you don't see it within by the end of next week, follow up with me and I'll make sure we get straightened out.
So let's see, a couple other questions in here. There's a long question from Jonathan Keevan, if I've pronounced that correctly, asking about, can CAS be used to, what about a learner that wants to see resources that accomplish a specific thing? So that's the question of finding resources that that match a particular competency. So again, CAS is the infrastructure for doing that. The little tagging tool provides a way to tag things with that, but the search would be done in the repository or registry or in some other ways. Now, that said, if somebody has a tool that makes sense to fit into this, then it is an open source project, and that's exactly why. So we'd be very happy to see those kinds of things develop. Simon asked who's paying for CAS. So the funding that for the people on this call that's supporting our time right now is coming from the ADL under their PAL BAA. But as far as the sustainment goes, long-term sustainment, that's another one of the important reasons why this is being structured the way it is. Grant funding doesn't last forever, and this is not meant to be something that is developed in 1 year and then disappears the next because there wasn't a source of funding for it.
Hey, Robbie, can I add to that? This is Jono. I see this much like the Project Tin Can effort that turned into XAPI. Along the way, there was a BAA effort that created some very interesting technology, and then that moved out to an open source group where it took on a whole other life when it hit the community. And we're hoping the same type of thing happens with CAS and our other competency projects. We know there's a lot of interest. We know that people are doing these things, and we know there's some struggles in the area. And, you know, CAS is, like many things at ADL, is a working code trumps all way of handling some of these problems. If we can make it work first, then document the APIs, and we have a good reference implementation of that middleware, people can take it and branch it and start using it, or even create their own systems that expose the interfaces and do things that we've never thought of, and that's where things really get interesting. So yeah, I think the community is key, and this is, like I said at the very beginning, the beginning, not the end of this whole effort. This is really the kickoff, and we hope to see many of you in other webinars and working group meetings as we move forward. All right, Robbie, anything else wrap-up-wise? And again, I know we haven't gotten through all the questions. We will get these out there to you, and we'll let them know, you know, how to find them.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's about it. And I think a big thanks goes to everybody who joined and listened in. And I know everybody was on mute, but thanks for all the questions. And of course, thanks for the interest and for listening. And we will get you copies of the slides. And as you heard earlier, there will be some attempt to at least distribute the recording, hopefully successful. And wish you all. Let us know when how we can help.
Great. Thanks, Robbie. And also, thanks to your guys behind the scenes. I don't know from an attendee point of view what you're able to see on the questions, but it looks like we have hundreds of questions. And you know, thanks to DJ and Fritz and Devlin and all the folks behind the scenes that were hurrying along to answer those questions. I thought it went well. We got through most of them, so really a good job there. We'll be in touch with you for more resources. And always keep an eye out on adlnet.gov. We'll have more sessions like this, other opportunities to learn. And, you know, we post information about all the projects we're working on there. So check that out, and feel free to contact us if you have any questions, comments, or concerns. And with that, last words, Robbie?
No last word.
All right.
No.
All right. All right, thanks everybody for taking the time out of your day to join the kickoff, and we hope to hear from you again soon. Have a good one.